Welcome to another Hoops and Dynaman Claymation tutorial. In this video, I'm going to show you how to make a pterodactyl. You will need the materials you see here on screen. I'll explain them as we go along. The first step is going to be to sculpt the body out of non-drying clay. I'm going to be using black clay. The overall coloration of this pterodactyl that I'm going to be using is going to be based slightly off of seagoing birds like gulls or albatrosses, where they're mostly neutral colored with darker colors on top and lighter colors on the bottom for counter shading, with more colorful beaks. I'll get into the brighter colors later on, but for the most part right now, I'm just going to be using black clay. Most of this clay is going to be covered up with plush later on, but the legs and feet at least will be sticking out in the final product, so I'm going to be using black clay for those. This isn't going to be the entire body that you're sculpting out of this clay here. The wings and the beak will be separate. For now, you're just going to be sculpting the head without the beak, the neck, the torso, the legs, and the feet. You'll want to make sure the legs, neck, and torso are approximately the same size as one another. Pterodactyls had 5 toes on each foot, although one toe was significantly smaller than the others. It's also believed that pterosaurs were capable of swimming, so I'm going to be adding some webbing to the toes here, so they'll look more like the toes of an aquatic bird. And then what you're going to do is insert some aluminum wire through the head and into the neck. Otherwise, it might flop to the ground with the added weight of the beak and the crest later on. But pterodactyl would have had a flexible neck in real life and would be able to hold their heads upright. So you want to be sure that the model that you're making is physically capable of doing that. Next, what I'm going to do, now that I have the outline of the body basically finished, is I'm going to make the wings. I'm going to be using the ruler to measure out the wing size so that it's accurate to the proportions of the real animal, which would look something like this. The wings are going to be made out of felt, and the reason for that is pterosaurs were not entirely scaly. They were covered in hair-like structures called pycnofibers, and so I'm going to be adding plush and artificial fur to other parts of the body later on. But for the wings, I'm going to be using felt, so it looks like there's a very, very light amount of pycnofibers on the wings. Also, the felt is a lot more flexible, and it'll be able to keep its shape better without tearing later on, as it would be if it was just made out of clay. So what I'm going to do first is take this permanent black marker and draw an outline of what the wings are going to look like so that I can cut it out later. I'm going to be using white felt here. The wings are going to be black on the top and white on the bottom. I'll use the marker to color in the black for the surface of the wings later on, but for now I'm just going to be drawing the outline of the wings on this white sheet of felt. The wings would also stretch all the way from the tips of the wings down to somewhere on the leg of the animal. It's not known exactly where the wing membranes would attach to the leg. It could have been anywhere from the knee down to the toes. For mine, I'm going to have the wings attached to the ankles, which is a possibility, and other artists who've done pterodactyls or other pterosaurs have done it that way as well. An easy mistake to make, based off of some older depictions of pterodactyls and other pterosaurs, is making the wingtips pointed, so they're more triangular, but that's actually not accurate, and it would make more sense aerodynamically to have the wingtips be more rounded rather than pointed. So that's what I'm going to be doing here when tracing it. After I've traced the outline for that first wing, I'm going to put another sheet of white felt on top of it so that you can still see the outline through the one that's on top, and trace very carefully the exact same shape. That way, both wings will be the exact same size and proportions and shape as one another, so that it'll look symmetrical when I attach them on later. And then, of course, I'm going to cut them both out using scissors. And then, as I said before, I'm going to use the black marker to color the wings so that they're black on top, but stay white on the bottom. Some of the black ink is going to bleed through to the other side that I want to keep white, but that's okay. I'm also going to be adding this little pattern here, similar to the wings of an albatross, where there's an outline of black even on the bottom of the wings. And the area of the wings that's going to be attaching to the legs is also going to be black, so I'm coloring that in as well. As you can see, I'm also using a sheet of paper to put underneath the wings as I'm coloring them in, so that if the ink bleeds through, it won't get onto the table, it'll just go onto this paper. After I have finished with that, I'm going to attach the wings to the body, but first they need to be given some structure to them. So I'm going to be using some aluminum wire to represent basically the arm and finger bones. The wings of a pterosaur wouldn't be sticking straight out from the body during flight. There'll still be a bend where the elbow is supposed to be. So what I'm going to do with this aluminum wire is create this shape that sort of looks like a square root sign, where the bend there is where the elbow is between the upper arm and the lower arm. It may be tempting to make the bend for the elbow halfway between the shoulder and the hand, but actually it should be closer to the shoulder. The pterodactyl's lower arm should be longer than the upper arm, and then the finger that makes up the rest of the wing would be longer even than that. So it should look like this when it's done. The aluminum wire should run about the length of the wing itself, but also with a little bit of extra aluminum wire sticking out, because that's the part that's actually going to stick into the clay section, so that'll be where it goes into the shoulder. That extra part of felt that's going to be above the elbow is actually important, because that's accurate to what pterodactyls actually looked like. They didn't just have membranes for their wings, but they also had membranes going from the upper arm to the lower arm. You also want to glue that wire to the top of the wings, not the bottom, so that's why it's going onto the black section. After the super glue dries, but before you actually insert them into the shoulders of the clay model, you're going to have to cover up the aluminum wire with some plush, which is supposed to be the pignofibers covering up the arm and the finger. First, what I'm going to do is take a strip of this black plush and sort of try to find the edges of where the aluminum wire would go underneath. So cut out some plush in the exact shape of the aluminum wire, but wider, so that it covers up the whole thing. You don't want to make it look like the arms are too thin, too skinny, because pterodactyls would have a lot of muscle in their arms to make sure that they were strong enough to actually flap their wings and fly. So after you've got the shape of the plush figured out, then you super glue that on. And then once that glue has dried, you can attach them to where they would go on the actual animal. Of course, in order to keep those wings in place, you're going to need more than just the aluminum wire that sticks into the shoulder area. You're also going to need to glue it on. So I'm going to put some super glue all along the edge where it's going to attach to the body. The last part you want to add to the wings is the fingers. Pterodactyls had four fingers. The fourth one would have been the longest one, which made up the entire length of the wing. So you've already got that one taken care of. But as for the other three, I'm going to be making those out of non-drying clay and then super gluing them onto the underside of the wing at the point where the hand would be. A common mistake that you would see in older depictions of pterosaurs would be for the fingers to be pointing straight out. But that was physically impossible. The fingers should be pointed away from the body. You also want to make sure that the fingers are not all the same size. They get longer as they approach the fourth finger. So the first finger would be the smallest, then the second finger longer, the third finger longer, and of course the fourth one is the longest of them all because it runs the length of the wing. So you'll want to do that for both hands, super glue them on, and when they're done, they should look something like this. Next, I am going to get to work on the beak. Now, the beak is going to be made out of air-drying clay, but since pterodactyls had teeth, I will need to have the teeth ready to insert into the beak before it actually dries. so I'm going to get to work on the teeth first. Pterodactyl had approximately 90 teeth, which is, you know, a lot for this little miniature model that I'm doing. So I'm going to be making the teeth out of toothpicks, and I'm not going to be able to show all of them. So for the sake of this model, it's going to have a reduced number of teeth that I can show. That is unfortunately just how it has to be. The teeth would get smaller and less visible with the mouth closed as you would go from the tip of the beak further back. So only the teeth up in the front would be prominent enough that I would have to use these toothpicks for them. But anyway, I'm going to first paint the tips of some toothpicks white. And while that paint is drying, I can get to work on actually creating the beak. The beak should be about the same length as the neck. So I'm going to create two almost identical pieces of air drying clay. Make sure that the undersides are flat. That way, when the mouth is closed, it'll look right. I'm also going to press them against the actual head so that they'll be flush with the head once that clay dries and it'll attach on the way it's supposed to. And like I said, before the air drying clay dries, I'm going to take those toothpicks, cut off the painted parts of the teeth, make sure there's still enough of a root there that they can be inserted and it'll stay there. The teeth are supposed to interlock with one another, so I want to make sure that there aren't two teeth that clash into each other and prevent the mouth from closing all the way. So I'm doing it very carefully, like this. And once the clay has dried and I now have the actual shape of the beak ready, I'm going to paint it. These colors are entirely speculative on my part, but like I said before, I'm basing this off of animals that occupied a similar niche to pterodactyls in the modern day, which are seagoing birds like gulls. And in those animals, the only non-neutral colors, the brighter colors, would be on the beak. And so I'm going to do something similar for that with my pterodactyl model. I'm going to have the beak and later on the crest have this yellowish color. So I'm going to paint the beak that color, then of course get some red to paint the inside of the mouth. And finally, once that paint has dried, I'm going to then super glue them onto the head where they're supposed to go. Next up is the crest. And the crest of Pterodactyl is interesting because it's not entirely known what the full crest would have looked like in life, because even though there are fossils of part of the crest sticking out of the back of the head, it's almost certain that there would have been some soft tissue covering it in life and that the real thing would have looked much bigger than just a little pointed thing on the back of the head. Also, most pterodactyl skeletons that have been found were not fully grown. There's only one adult skull from a pterodactyl that's been discovered. So the crest probably would have gotten bigger than what we've seen in the juvenile skeletons as the creature got older. So I'm completely speculating on what the shape and size of this crest would be here. I'm basing it off of this speculative crest shape from Mark Witten, which seems to have a lot of thought put into it as to why it would look like this. So that's what I'm going to be using for the shape of my pterodactyl's crest. This sort of half circle shape. After I've gotten that sculpted out of air drying clay and flattened the way I want it to, I'm going to press it against the head of the model so that it'll be flush with it once it's actually dried. Want to make sure that it'll attach at the back of the head the way it's supposed to, so that it'll go from the back of the head to about the middle of the beak. And then, of course, once it's dried, I'm going to paint it. Again, the colors are entirely speculative on my part. You can use different colors if you want. I'm using this yellow with red stripes sort of look to it, so that it'll be more eye-catching, which is, again, something that I've based off of modern-day birds, and I don't think would be too unrealistic for a pterosaur. I took a lot of inspiration from modern-day bird behavior for the scenes that I have in this video that I'm making this model for. For one thing, it takes place on a beach and out over the sea, so I have the pterodactyls acting sort of like seabirds, like gulls, where they're scavenging along the shoreline at low tide. There's going to be a lot of dead animals, like fish and squid there that they're scavenging on, which is something that you see modern day birds doing as well. I also have a brief little scene where one pterodactyl is grooming another pterodactyl. This is something that modern day birds will do. They'll groom each other, get rid of parasites on areas of the body like the head and neck that they can't reach. So it's a social behavior that birds do that perhaps pterosaurs did as well, since pterosaurs needed to keep their pygna fibers clean also. I also have them diving for fish in a similar way to birds like gannets, where they fold up their wings and dive into the water head first from above and swim around with their wings above their heads, kicking with their feet. It's believed that pterosaurs could swim to at least an extent. I don't have them swimming quite as fast as gannets are able to, but for the most part, that's where I'm getting the idea for this behavior from. Next, I'm going to add some plush for the pygna fibers on the rest of the body. Once again, I'm going to be using this black plush like I used for the arms, and that's going to be for the back of the animal. I'm also going to be cutting out a tiny little bit that's supposed to be the small tail of the pterodactyl, which will also be part of this plush, as it's also supposedly covered with those pygna fibers. I'm going to super glue that onto the back, and then I'm going to take some white plush and cut that out and super glue it onto the belly, trying to make sure that none of the clay underneath is showing. Don't want to see the seams too much. And now I'm going to take some artificial fur and add that to the neck. Pterodactyl had a mane of pygna fibers on its neck, so this artificial fur has longer hairs, which can be seen as longer pygna fibers on this section of the body. So I'm going to take a box cutter and cut that out. Not going to use scissors, because then some of the hairs themselves would get cut, and I don't want that to happen. I'm going to cut out a section that will cover the entirety of the neck, super glue that on, and then finally add some plush to the head itself. So I'm going to have to wrap that around the section that I want and cut out the shape of the plush that I want that will cover it up, but not cover up the beak or the crest in any way. Next, I'm going to attach the eyes. As always, I'm going to be using glass eyes. The eyes that I'm using are bird-like eyes. They're yellow, so matching the color of the beak and the crest there, which I think makes sense for this animal. It's entirely speculative, of course. After super gluing one of the eyes on, you want to make sure that the other one is attached in such a way that it's completely symmetrical, which can be difficult at first. You also want to make sure that the eyes are frontward facing, as it would be for a predator. And last but not least is going to be adding the skin texture to the legs and the feet. As always, I'm going to make these molds using air dry clay and some pre-existing reptile toys to give it that scaly texture. The legs are going to have some smaller scales, and the feet are going to have larger scales in order to look like the pads that pterodactyl had on its feet, which is known from footprints. And once that's all done, I'm going to put it at its default position of walking on all fours, like this. So this is what it should look like when it's done. Thank you all for watching. If there's any mistakes I made or any suggestions or animals you want me to make clay videos of in the future, let me know in the comment section. Thank you to all of my patrons that you see here on screen, and I will see you next time.